Hi everyone, this is Santosh Kumar DK, Assistant Professor, Department of Computer Science and Engineering, Canara Engineering College, Mangaluru. I am going to discuss Computer Organization course with subject code 18CS34. In this course, we will study the organization of the digital computer, the peripheral connections, memory organization, and also the little bit discussion about ALU and CU working. The study material regarding this course is available on the given website. You are free to refer the website for the study material. Welcome back. Second concept is bus structure. The bus structure is going to tell how we are going to connect different parts inside a computer together. The definition of the bus goes like this: a group of lines that serves as a connecting path for several devices is called bus. That means it's a group of lines, it's a collection of wires which are connecting the multiple devices. It can be a normal wired path, it can be embedded on the board also. So, but the main intention is it's going to have a path between those two devices to transfer the data. These bus can be categorized into three categories. One is the address bus. The job of the address bus, we have seen in the previous discussion that there was a bus. I'll just go back to the previous discussion. Yeah, there is a bus over here. You can notice from MER to main memory, there is a bus. So this bus carries only address. Always it's going to carry the address. And there is a bus between main memory and MDR. MDR stands for memory data register. So this carries always the data, and there is a bus between control unit and the memory unit. So this is going to carry always control signals. So this is address bus, this is a data bus, and this is a control bus. All these three are very important in computer. So individually, what is the job of that? Address bus is responsible for carrying the address signals, data bus is responsible for carrying the data signals, control bus is responsible for carrying the control signals. We'll see a simple architecture where we are having the same IO devices with memory connected to processor. This is a single bus architecture where you can see that some are unidirectional connection, some are bidirectional connection. You can check input device is responsible for what? It's going to give only input. It cannot take anything from us, right? So that's why it's going to give only input from the device to the bus, and output device is responsible for taking. It's going to take the values to display, and it's going to give the values to the memory unit and processor, and it's going to take the values from the memory unit and the processor. But here you can store the data, you can also retrieve the data, right? So that's why this is bidirectional. And processor can take the data from input device and it can send the data to output device. But processor can read the value from the memory and it can store the value to the memory. That's why this is also bidirectional. So here, if input device is using this single bus, then no other devices can use the single bus. This is the drawback of single bus. If you are having a multi-bus, dedicated bus for each, then the task will be completed faster compared to the single bus architecture. This is the main one drawback of the single bus architecture. But the maintenance of this single bus architecture is simple than the multi-bus architecture. Again, there is a drawback and there is a advantage also. And with respect to cost, single bus architecture cost you less and multi-bus architecture cost you more, because you have to invest for more hardware devices. Next, there is a speed issue, right? Because input device, we have seen in the previous diagram, input device is there, the keyboard. Output device can be a monitor or printer. I can take the memory, okay, faster than these two, and processor faster than all of these. Yes, now the different devices have different transfer and operate speed, right? when it comes to a keyboard or the display or printer, these are slower than the processor. We know that because processor is the fastest person on the computer. So now to cope up with all these, like for example, I'm giving some 100 prints together. Now all 100 prints will not come together in a printer when there is only one printer. So what we have to do, we have to wait until one has completed, the next will be getting their slot, and next will be completed, the another one will be getting a slot. Like that it goes on, right? For that, how to solve this issue when you are having a different speed people working together? So what we can do is, we have to go with the concept of buffers. So whatever I say, like print these 100 documents, a processor is given an instruction and it is stored in a buffer, and printer responsible for reading that buffer and printing one by one, which we call as a pool buffer in the printer. Similarly in keyboard, actually in whatever speed you are going to type, it will be printed on the keyboard. But on some situation, on some time, what happens is, whenever, because if your system is too slow, heavily loaded with all the operations, and the configuration is less, when you are typing, sometimes it happens, it types after a millisecond delay, which you can notice also. That is because of, there is some mismatch in the speed, and how whatever you typed, how it's going to retrieve with the help of buffers. This is the main issue with respect to the connecting multi-speed devices together. And main factor over here is, in the computer, how we can increase the speed of the computer by going with all these multi-speed devices, and still I have a high-speed device called processor, and little slow one is main memory, slower one is like a hard disk, input-output device, and many other devices. How, by having all these, how we can come up with the best performance? Now, there are three main factors which affects the performance of the computer. One is the hardware design. What type of designing technology they have used? I've shown you in the demo of when I'm converting a C program to the assembly language code. There I've shown you that different architectures are there. Each is meant for its own like design architecture. They work with their own specification. Those are going to play a major role in the performance. If you are going to tell, yes, addition operation, I have discussed in the previous discussion, addition operation, the operand R1 and R0 are there in the registers. The operands are available in the register in R1 and R0, then the operation can be completed faster than add LOCA comma R0. What it is? One operand, LOCA is a memory location, R0 is a register. So if you are going to do this, like compared to add LOCA, I'll just write rather than confusing you guys. Add LOCA comma R0. The other one is add R1 comma R0. Out of these two, which is faster? This will be faster because both the operands are there very close to processor. They are there inside the processor. You can recall from the diagram that R0 to RN minus 1 are the general purpose register, which are used for temporary purpose, and these two are inside the processor. And when it is very close, and when it is the register, registers are faster than the normal memory. So that's why this again takes time to retrieve the location, fetch the location, get the data in the MDR, then you perform the operation. This takes time, but this will not take so much of time as it takes. That's why I said it is purely based on the hardware design. What type of hardware you have designed. And based on that hardware design, you are going to tell my instruction set demands, addition demands both the operands on registers. I don't support this type of architecture. I don't support one operand can be on a memory location, one should be on always on a register. There can be one more architecture where both operands can be on A, B, A, comma B. A is a memory location and B is also memory location. Both can be on a memory location. This takes more time compared to this. and this, because both are on memory location. What is the meaning of this? It is B is equal to A plus B, because this is the destination, right? B is equal to A plus B. It means get the data from memory, get the data from perform the addition directly on memory and store the answer back to the memory. So again, there is a more memory operation. This takes more time. So how the performance will be degraded and can be improved by the hardware design and the instruction set. The next one is the software, which we rarely discuss in this course. We don't discuss much about softwares. We discuss more about hardware things. But still, there is the one software, system software called compiler, can also play a major role in the performance improvement. How it can play a major role? Because you have seen, what is the job of compiler? The program in high level language will be converted to object code, I said, right? Let it be the high level language is C, and the object code what we are going to take as assembly languages, which we have seen in the demonstration. So to which architecture it's going to convert, what all the instructions it's going to take up, and along with that, whether our compiler is parallelly supporting, it's going to support the parallel architecture. So if it is going to support the parallel architecture, because right now we are aware we are going with a multi-core architectures, and if your compiler is a sequential architecture one, it cannot utilize all the multi-cores. If it's a parallel architecture based compiler, then it can utilize all the cores which are available on your processor. Then it's going to improve the performance. It means I have 10 students with me. I always tell only one student to help me out, and remaining 9 are idle. Rather than doing that, what I can do, I should be smart enough to utilize all the 10 students so that my task can be completed faster way. It's not so easy to handle all 10 students together, because I have to remember what I have assigned to all 10 students. Similarly, the parallel compilers designing is also complicated, but compiler can also play a major role in improving the performance of the computer. So when it comes to computer, what all the other hardware things can improve? First one, we call it as a small cache memory, can also improve the performance. So what exactly it is, cache memory? We'll see that in next slide. So what is the job of using this cache memory? It is the fastest memory in the computer. If we are going to take the memories, like we are having a secondary memory, and we are having a primary memory, and we are having a cache memory, and we are having a registers, and this is the one which is very close to computer, like processor. Whenever I say computer, it's a processor, and this is inside the processor. And cache memory, partially some part of the cache memory is inside the processor, some can be outside also. Virtually we can create the system software can also create. And on the next level, this is there, this is outside the processor, and this is the slowest one, which is again outside the processor. And now if we are going to get multiple levels of cache, if you have seen any processor specification, you might have heard L1 cache, L2 cache, L3 cache. So if you are going with the current processor specification, right now we in market we are having a i9th processor with 10th generation. So if you go and check any processor specification, you'll get levels of cache which is supported by that particular processor. So now these job is to increase the performance in terms of speed. But of course, if you are going to go for a complicated hardware architecture which is going to improve the performance, of course it's going to play a major part in the cost. I took a term i9 processor just now, Intel i9 processor. So this is costlier than our dual core processor. Why? Because it is having so much of hardware support to improve the performance. So that's why it also directly reflects on the cost. And next is a memory management. If you are going with again the high end processor and all, like the memory management, memory supported by them is also more. When you are going to support more memory, again it's a complicated task. Is you have to address, you have to remember many bits, many things has to happen. But all these can improve the performance. How? Speed, of course, we know if you are going with the high-end processor, the speed is there. Of course, it's going to reflect on the cost. And memory management, what all the memory management techniques you are having, like mapping techniques, or else it can be the storage techniques, how we are going to store and how we are retrieving, that also plays a major role in the performance. For example, I'll take a simple example where you are going to throw your notes or textbooks everywhere in your room. Then if I ask you to fetch something directly, you cannot fetch it because you have to search throughout your room. But if you are going to arrange them in a rack properly, so if I ask, I want this particular notes, directly you can go to the particular rack, particular section, and you pick out that particular notes, then it is faster than like searching through inside the complete room or complete home. So this is what is memory management. Such type of techniques also play a major role in the improvement of the performance. Next, we'll see a little bit about cache. We'll discuss in detail about cache and memory organization in module 3. The cache is the one which placed on the processor. I told you already, this is purely based on the processor cache memory. So why we need a cache? Even though we say from till today that like we are having a secondary memory over here, which we call it as a hard disk. So this is also connected to this, which is slower, which is too slow compared to the processor. And we need a person who can cope up with the speed of secondary memory and the processor. The intermediate person who is faster than this person, I can write like this. Yeah, one sec. Yep, this is faster than this, and this is slower than this. Main memory is faster than the secondary memory and slower than the processor. To cope up with the speed between these two again, main memory and the processor, we got one more. Yeah, we got one more memory, that is cache memory. The cache memory is responsible for, actually I have to write the arrows properly. Yeah, and with respect to size, it is bigger. This is bigger than this. Yeah, now again, cache is the faster than main memory so that it can cope up with the speed of processor. Again, processor is having, I said, something called registers, so which we have seen R0 to Rn, they are faster than the cache. But with respect to size, this arrows, whatever I have written, that is based on the speed. If I am going to write with respect to size, I'll write that in a yellow color. Secondary memory is larger than main memory. Main memory is larger than cache memory, and cache memory is larger than registers. But with respect to speed, they vary. But we need frequently used over here, highly frequently used over here, and most frequently used over here, so that the task can be completed in faster way. So here we introduce a new term called cache memory, which is going to play a mediator between main memory and the processor. It means registers. Where by using this we can improve the performance. Next, another way we can increase the performance is processor clock. The processor circuit are controlled by a timing signal called clock. What exactly it is? It's a timing signal. How fast your processor can execute a given instruction. It means how fast it can generate a timing signal. If it is going to generate a timing signal one cycle per 1 second, then it's the slowest processor. If it's going to generate a processor cycle in nanoseconds or lesser than that, then they are faster. So based on this also, we are going to tell this particular processor is faster. Might be you heard something called like 1 gigahertz, 2 gigahertz. These are all the clocking speed, which again we are going to see in the next slide. Clock cycles. The clock cycle defines the regular time intervals called clock cycles. The time interval between one clock and second clock, the complete thing, is called as a clock cycle. And here, why we need this clock and clock cycle? Because whatever the instruction I take, every instruction generally Again, it based on the architecture, but generally I speak, every instruction should go through all these four stages, which we call it as the basic steps. Every instruction should go through these basic steps in their life cycle when they are going to be executed. First, what it is? First, fetch the instruction from the memory. See, there is a RAM, main memory. I have to fetch the instruction add, and I have to understand what is add. I have to decode and I have to understand. So we know English, we know what add it is, but the computer don't know English. What it has to do, it is having some unique number. For example, I can take 10. 10 means add, 11 means subtract, 12 means product, 13 means divide. I'm just giving this random number on my assumption to explain to you. So now, if it is add, computer will not understand. So this should be converted to this number. Yes, if it is 10, then control will understand it's a add. It's going to tell add two numbers. Then what it has to do, it has to fetch these two. It has to find these two operands. This is completely done by the decode stage. Then execute. What is the job? Addition. So who is responsible for executing the instruction, which I told in the previous slides that it is arithmetic and logical unit. So we can check whether it's arithmetic operation. Yes, of course, addition is a arithmetic operation. So it's going to perform the task. And finally, after that, where the answer should be? Answer should go back to RAM. It might be, it is not necessary always. It might end at that place itself, or it may go to the write back. That's what I told. It is the general discussion, four stages. It may go to 3 stage, it may go to 5 stage, it may go to 6 stage. It depends on the architecture, but generally I have taken 4 stages. Next, we'll see clock rate. This is what I said about hertz. Like you might heard about 2.3 gigahertz speed processor or 4.3 gigahertz speed processor. So these are measured with the clock rate. The length of P of one clock cycle is an important parameter that affects the processor performance. The inverse is clock rate. What is P? It's the length of one clock cycle. Like, I'll just show you how the clock cycle should be. If I take a clock cycle, the clock cycle will go like this. Yeah, this is what is the clock cycle is. This is the complete clock cycle. I'll write your analog clock cycle also. Like, this is how the analog clock cycle looks. Like, there will be a positive peak and there will be a negative peak. That complete thing is called as a one signal which goes with the time. So similarly, this is a digital clock. So what we are going to do, there is a high also, there is a sorry. There is high also, there is a low. The combination of low and high is called as a one clock cycle. So this clock cycle, how fast it can generate that clock cycle, based on that we are going to measure the clock rate, how fast it's going to generate that. So the timing, it might be generated in 1 nanosecond, or it might be lesser than that. So that is what's going to measure by the clock rate. And we are having next basic performance equation. This equation is a little important. Based on this, numericals can be asked. So where we are, it's a very simple equation. RM, so you can remember, no need to worry much about it. Like there are some four parameters over here. What is T? T is the time required to execute a given program. For example, addition of two number program, the total time required to complete that program. And N is the number of actual machine instruction. How many machine instructions are there? For example, I have shown you in a demo, there are N number of instructions which will be converted when it is C to the machine language. It means the machine architecture dependent. Based on the architecture also, we have noticed it may vary. The numbers may vary. Like one may have 5 instructions, one may have 10 instructions for the same task. And even we have seen in the previous one, addition, we have performed directly. Add LOC A and or not. This is with only one instruction I can complete the complete task. And one more explanation I have told, LOC A should be loaded to R1. And next add R0, R1 with R0. Yep. Now what happened? The same task is done by two instructions. So N is going to tell this one how many instructions are there. Next, S. S is the average number of basic steps required. See how many basic steps are required. I discussed about the basic steps in the previous case. You can see this is the basic step. Each instruction can have 4, 5, 3, 2, depends on the instruction. Like that is going to be said by the S. It's going to tell how many basic steps for each instruction. Like there are two instructions over here, how many basic steps are there? It can be in this only three can be there, in this also only three can be there. So three into two it can be six, and over here if it can be four also, it can be five also, it can be six also, depends. And finally, what you are going to do, we are having a clock rate. Clock rate, I have told you 2.3 gigahertz, 1 megahertz, 500 megahertz, 1 gigahertz. Like that, we are going to get some clock rate of each individual processor. Based on that, we are going to tell this program can run so much faster in this architecture. So we'll see one example on that. See, the example is very clear. We are going to have a 1000 instructions. Out of that, 25%. Instruction requires 4 clock cycles. It means it is having 4 basic steps. Each basic step is completed in 1 clock cycle. It means it is having 4 basic steps. That's why it is going to take 4 clock cycle. And remaining 40% requires 5 clock cycles. As I said, basic steps may vary. So now the remaining 40%, 25% over here means 250 instruction, 40% means 400 instructions. The 400 instructions will take 5 clock cycles, and the remaining, so 250 plus 400 is 650, remaining is 350, will take 3 clock cycles. Out of 1000, this is what is the distribution. And this program, which is having 100 instruction, is running on the 1 gigahertz processor, running on the 1 gigahertz processor machine. Let's see how to compute this. So first you find this distributed value, that 25% is having 4 clock cycle, 40% is having 5 clock cycle, and remaining is having 3 clock cycles. Then find the N into S, like individually how to do this, 250 into 4 and 400 into 5 and 350 into 3, add the answer and divide that by 1 gigahertz. The finally this 1000 instruction program with the varied clock cycle requirement can finish on 1 gigahertz processor by 4.05 microseconds. This is how the processor architecture and the instruction set architecture hardware design plays a major role in deciding the time required to complete a given program. And we have one more example. I'll leave this for you to complete. It's very simple. It is not like the previous one. It is they are going to tell the S size is 1.25. It takes 1.25 as an average. They have taken average of all the instruction and they told. And N is 200. It means 200 into directly you perform 1.25 and divided by 500 megahertz. 500 megahertz. So the final answer will be T, the time taken to, you do this, you will get an answer. This is the time taken to complete the 200 instruction program on 500 megahertz processor with the average size of S is 1.25. Hope this is clear to you. Next, we have pipelining and superscalar operation. Along with the previously discussed upgradation, like how to improve the performance, so what are the parameters? We have seen the formula that T is equal to n multiplied by s over clock rate, right? So in this, by improving what all the factors, this can execute faster. See, all these three can play a major role. If you are going to reduce the number of instruction on your computer, like on your program, so then automatically performance will be increased. And what if your basic steps is less? If you are going to have an instruction which is having a less number of basic steps, and if you are using such instructions more in your program, then that is also going to play a major role. And the other one is the clock rate. You are having a high end processor which may clock in terms of 2.3 gigahertz, or it can be something like 4.5 gigahertz. Like if you are having a high speed processor, then also it can play a major role in improving the performance. Along with this, if we are going to do something more in our hardware configuration, hardware designing, can we improve? Yes, it is possible. That is going to be said by the pipelining, which we are not going to do actually. That is done by the hardware designer, hardware vendors. But that is also going to play a major role in improving the performance. This is like writing the program which takes less number of instruction is in with our with us. Like we can write a simplified version, like rather than using unwanted statements, we can go with the only required statements. Yes, reduction of S size is not with us, again it's with a vendor who designed the hardware. And with respect to R, yes, we can buy a high-end processor, but like always we have to think of cost also, whether it's worth of paying so much for that processor. Are we going to use so much processing speed always? So what we can do is, yes, we can do something along with this. Our processors are going to come up with some more architecture. So actually what we say, I said generally, if I take an instruction, one instruction will be having four stages, right? One is fetch, decode, execute, and write back. These are all the four stages generally I speak. So if I am taking one instruction and each basic stage is executed in one clock cycles, to complete this, how much I need? 1 plus 1 plus, again, so totally I need 4 clock cycles, right? So after this, consider I'm having 4 instructions in my program, 4 instructions, each takes 4 clock cycle. It means 4 into 4, how many clock cycles? It takes 16 clock cycles to complete these 4 instructions. These are all the instructions, right? 16 clock cycles are required to finish this complete program. So can we improve this internally? Yes, it is possible. That is with the help of pipelining and superscalar operation. So we'll see what it is. Instructions are not necessarily executed one after another. Here with this discussion, what I did, first 4 clock cycle I executed first instruction, next 4 clock cycle I executed second instruction, next I executed third instruction with next 4 clock cycle. Again, in the final 4 clock cycle, I executed the third instruction, one after another I did. But it is not necessary to be executed like that. We can execute them without one after state. That we will see with the help of pipeline. The value of S does not have to be the number of clock cycle to be executed or executed one instruction. Like this, on this S value, we can also reduce. So how this can be done? Overlapping is possible. One after another need not to be done. We can do overlapping concept. It means one is executing, still it is executing, I can bring the other one. And the other one is still executing, I can bring the third one. And the third one is still it is executing, I can bring the one more, last one. That is possible. That concept we call it as a pipelining. Pipelining is nothing but overlapping the execution of the successive instruction. The one instruction example we have taken, add R1, R2, R3, which is a 3 operand instruction. It means R1 and R2 is added and the answer is stored in the R3. So I am giving two operands and the destination together in this instruction. Again, it is based on the architecture. Next, there is something called superscalar operation. Multiple instructions pipelines are implemented in the processor. This pipelining is a concept which is overlapping the execution. If it is implemented inside the processor, that is called as a superscalar operation. What is the main intention of this? Goal is to reduce the S value. That is what I said. S can be reduced. How we can reduce, we will see in the next slide. See, as I said, if I'm having four instruction, each takes four stages, four clock cycles. See, if I'm going to take fetch is a different part, fetch is a different hardware unit which is responsible always for fetching the content. Decode is one more hardware unit which is always responsible for decoding, and execution is ALU. So again, ALU is responsible for executing a instruction. Write back again one more hardware unit which is responsible for performing the write back operation. Right now, when I fetch the first instruction, you can notice when I fetch the first instruction on the second clock cycle, actually here decode is working, fetch is free. So in meantime, can I ask the fetch to fetch the second instruction? Yes, it is possible because he is free already. And on the third clock cycle, you can notice execution of the first instruction is going on, but decode is free. So can I ask decode to decode the second instruction? Here 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4 is meant for the instruction number. They are not the different hardware devices. F, D, E and W are the same devices. These numbers are going to tell the instruction number. Now decode unit is free. On the third clock cycle, I am demanding decode to decode the second instruction which is already fetched. In meantime, you can notice fetch is also free. I will demand fetch to bring the third instruction. And next, on the fourth clock cycle, execution unit is free, ALU is free, and write back of first instruction is going on. Write back device is working. So now what I have to do? I can engage this execution unit, ALU. So now, during the fourth clock cycle, I am parallelly executing the second instruction. And meantime, decode is also free. I already fetched the third instruction. I am going to decode it. And in meantime, fetch is free. So what I do? Fourth instruction is fetched. And on the fifth clock cycle, the write back of this is over. So first instruction is completed. And on the fifth clock cycle, I am finishing the second instruction. If I am doing it one after another, 4 plus 4, it is 8. But right now I finished in the 5th clock cycle. And on the 6th clock cycle, I am writing the 3rd instruction. And on the 8th clock cycle, I am going to write the 4th instruction. It means what I did, I have reduced it by 2. Like previously I said, these 4 takes, 4 cross 4 is 16. But now we have reduced it to 8. So this is possible with the help of pipeline and superscalar operation. This is the motto behind going with the pipeline and superscalar support in the processor, which is going to reduce the number of clock cycle. Here I am not going to change the instruction. I am not going to change the basic steps. I am not going to bring a new hardware. Only what I am doing is I am embedding some more structures inside our hardware processor so that the task can be completed faster than the previous. See, previously I took 16 clock cycles, now I am taking only 8 clock cycles. What if I am going to add one more instruction, 5, then it will be finished in clock cycle 9. So actually it should be here, it's going to finish, fifth one is going to finish over here. Actually, if I go one after another, it should take 20 clock cycles, but it is going to finish in 9 clock cycles. That is the beauty of going with pipelining and superscalar operation. Next, how to improve the IC clock rate? If you are going to improve, then here you are having a IC technology to be used, and with that you come up with the circuits which is faster, and where again you can concentrate on the instruction, where you can reduce the basic steps, or you can have a complex instruction with less number of instructions, reduced and CISC format which I'm going to discuss here is CISC and RISC. CISC is a complex instruction set computer. RISC is a reduced instruction set computer. Both are having their own advantage and disadvantage. CISC is going to have support more number of instruction. RISC is going to support limited number of instruction. For example, the best example for CISC is our computers are designed with a CISC complex instruction set computer architecture. Our mobiles are designed with RISC reduced instruction set computers. Like these processors are designed with these, because why we need complex is which should support multiple operations. It is like, for example, I'll tell you, I don't know how to perform the multiplication, I don't know how to find the product, but you may suggest me you can do with adding the numbers so many times. For example, I want to perform this 2 × 3. I don't know how to do this right now. What you may tell, add 2 3 times, right? 2 plus, I know how to add, right? 2 2 and 2, I got answer 6. This is what is RISC is going to do, but CISC is going to perform this operation. Like directly it's going to support multiplication, but RISC is not going to do this. Where I have performed how many addition? 2 additions. Here I can do directly multiplication. So RISC is going to have less number of instructions, which may increase in the number of instructions in the program, but the basic steps may vary. But CISC is having a complex instructions which is going to support the high level operations, and basic steps may vary, but it's going to reduce the number of instructions in the program. Either we are going to increase the value of n, or we are going to reduce the value of n, which is going to play a major role in, we have already seen, n and s are going to play a major role in improving the performance of the given program. Or else we are having compilers. I told you before this, the compiler can utilize the multi-core architecture, or they can come up with a parallel computing architecture. So this is something which can, like, we are having a hardware which can do beyond its limit. For that, I need a software which is smart enough to utilize that hardware. That is what is compiler is. Compiler can come up with a parallel architecture, parallelly it can make the processor to run all the instructions in a given time. And the compiler should have like knowledge of dependent, independent variables. Only independent variables can be executed parallelly. Dependent variables has to run one after another. These are the decisions the compiler has to take. And again, but by doing this, compiler can also improve the performance of the execution of the program. And next, we are having a performance measurement. Next concept is performance measurement. How to measure the computer performance? If you are a hardware vendor, you are going to come up with your own hardware, you cannot tell my machine is faster. You should have to compare that with the another machine which is given by the standard people. Like there is an association called System Performance Evaluation Corporation, which we call it as a SPEC. SPEC is going to rate your machine. How they are going to rate your machine? So you have to run your computer, like whatever the hardware you have done, used, you have designed. So this is the computer under test and the reference computer. For example, on my computer, I take 5 seconds to complete the task. One complex program which takes 5 seconds to complete the task. And on the reference computer, it may take 7 seconds. For example, here I'm going to tell my computer is faster. Like this, I have to go with the benchmarks. There is something called benchmark. The standard program set, standard problem statements has been given to tell this processor is best. It is not only with the addition of 2 number program, I cannot decide my program is best. My processor is best. It can complete the task faster than the other. But there might be some other test cases where I may fail. For example, if you are going to tell that I can perform the addition faster, it can be only the single digit addition, I will do it faster. What if you give me some 10 digit addition, then I may fail, right? I may be slower than you, or your friend may be slower than you, because it depends on the input you cannot go with only one simple input benchmark. Rather than calling a input, I will call it as a benchmark. I cannot decide this is the one input benchmark which is going to decide this particular system is best. You have to have such type of all the benchmarks. If your system is performing best in all the benchmarks, then you can tell my hardware, whatever I have designed, is best than the reference computer, the similar configuration from the different vendor. So it is better than this. This is how even you can see mobile reviews also been given, laptop reviews has also been given, and cars, all the reviews, they are going to compare only with the similar referencing product. They are not going to take one mobile from like some 10,000 range and with the iPhone with some lakhs range. They are not comparing these two. Why? Because they are having their own hardware configuration. We have to get a respective similar product and we have to compare. Then only you can tell our product is best. And such type of multiple comparisons need to be done, then final the product of that is going to give you the rating for your performance. This is how the performance is measured by a spec for a given hardware. Then how else you can improve the performance? Rather than always going for a new hardware to be bought, we are having a similar specification, multiple computers. What we can do, we can come up with a multiple computer. You can use a like multi-computer architecture network and all, and we can make them a distributed system, and with that distributed system we can compute the given task faster than the others. Or else if you are having a multiprocessors, I said multiprocessors or multi-cores, if you are having those things, yes, you can come up with a software which can manage all these things and you can finish the task faster. Rather buying a new hardware, like I am having i5 now, buying a i9 is not always solution. If you are having i5 two machines, yes, you can make them a multi-computer system and divide the task among them and give it to them. It might be faster than your i9 which you are going to buy in the brand new one, because it's going to improve the performance. Thank you.